Tonight is for me the high point of the lecture series. It's the one I'm most looking forward, In some sense, there was this idea that we would find people that could tell different stories about different buildings from points of view other than architect. Clearly, the two that would be the most important to get were the client, which we couldn't get anybody to come tell a nice story about, so I gave up on that, and the engineer. I've had the privilege to know three world-class engineers personally very well, Guy Nordenson, Klaus, and Cecil Bauman. They're impressive. It's incredible fun to know all these guys. I got interested and took a strong interest in the work of Schleich, who's a German architect who solved the double curvature glass system. And I was talking about this with Klaus earlier. It's really interesting to me because some of those engineers have very strong signatures in their work. Like, it's almost impossible not to know a Schleich project when you see it. And of all the architects who I think are that people seek from all over the world to work with that have the least presence of their own hand, at least to my eye in their work, is Klaus Bollinger. Which makes him, in my opinion, the most interesting engineer working today. He works for, as you would expect, all the most important designers: Frank Gehry, Sana, Zaha Hadid, UN Studio. But he also works with some young and interesting architects, people that are you don't quite know yet, but you will know soon. Like, I know they're not falling down. It's an old habit.
Just a second. Wait a minute.
You know, like Wolfgang Schepeller, so as a sort of an exercise, and I'm going to do this with my class tomorrow, is I've been looking at projects that some of those architects did with other engineers and with Klaus, and there is a way that I think Klaus's work comes closest to what I imagine it to mean to render an architect's work as closely as a third party could do to an artist's work. It's fantastic. And the only story I could think about this is, he's dead now, but there was a great pianist who moved to Columbus, Ohio when he was 80 years old. His name was Earl Wild, because he wanted to record his end. Do you know Earl? No. You're not a pianist, are you? Okay, because this could be made up, and I'm not really sure. So, I mean, I make up a lot of stories. So I hate that when people in the audience actually know better. But this is a true story, I swear to God. Anyway, he moved here because he wanted to record his last set of recordings. And Columbus, Ohio is where the world's most famous piano tuner for the stars is. This is a person who knows enough about Steinway pianos that he can tune each piano to the specific sound of a pianist. And so he's flown all over the world. No matter who you are as a famous pianist, you're going to fly this guy in, and he will often get paid more than the pianist, because he has an incredible capacity to bring out not just the large strokes, but the nuances and subtleties in a body of work. And for me, that's what's fantastic about Klaus Bollinger's work. It's really an honor for us to have him here, and as a personal friend, I'm really great to see him. So let me introduce the engineer and now dean of the Angewandte School of Architecture, or Angewandte in general, Klaus Bollinger.
Thank you, Jeff, for this great introduction. Good evening, all together. I already had a pleasure this afternoon to see your school and see the work which was done in this Karamba workshop. Clemens especially did together with Justin. I have to say, great work, and I have the impression it's a great school here. That's why it's a real honor for me being here, and thank you for the invitation. So when I thought about how should I about this lecture and what to show. So I went through the last years of our work, and I thought there were a lot of changes, and the tools changed, and there were lots of challenges. And when I thought over this, I saw there is, and this is what something you mentioned already, in other words, different words, that there is something like a red thread going through the work we did. So I will show you now our work in the recent, I took 18 years from 95, and show several steps in this work. I have to take this. No. So I will start with one, with a project which we saw today in a very little model. We did with Coop Pimmelblau, the UFA Cinema Center in Dresden. It's the first freeform building which was done in Germany, Europe, or I do not know. So this is how it looks. It's a concrete block with the cinemas in it, and a foyer, which is a tilted, inclined glass structure, which looks like as if gravity would not exist. And this is a very important issue for when in the work with Coop Pimmelblau, Wolf hates gravity. And if I work with him, I hate it as well. Sometimes I work with different, with other architects, so then I have to say, okay, let's make the columns a bit thicker, for gravity is a very important thing. But my personal feeling is I hate gravity too. So I like to work with Wolf. Yeah, and you see, the dream of flying is everywhere. This is Yves Klein, so it, you see, gravity does not exist. And what we did this time, I was not, I had to figure it out new. We did what Caramba nowadays does by hand. Yeah, we, with our that time poor tools, with our program, we considered a structure and saw where the red areas are, and there we enforced it by hand and introduced new elements to reinforce it. And parallel, we did it in the model. And then we went back again to the calculation, back and forth. And that's what Caramba now does in thousands of steps in a very short time. So that's the inside of this crystal. So another very important step is when we started building bubbles. We started with a small bubble with Bernhard Franken. Bernhard Franken was, as Craig Lynn here did, Bernhard Franken introduced tools like Maya into architecture. So, and he created this, this bubble drop-like thing by Maya. He stopped the movement in when they came together, and this frozen structure then has to be built. We would not have been able to build it if we would not, if there would not be Rhino. Yeah, we were one of the first offices, special engineering offices, using Rhino. It was at that time the better version. So, and we cladded it with acrylic, the acrylic, double curved acrylic, on created by milling foam glass. So now we do things like that very often, and it's nothing strange, but it's 13 years ago, it was quite new. So then came a bigger bubble, which was the Kunsthaus in Graz with Peter Cook and Colin Fournier. Peter did the competition without a 3D model that time. They created this wonderful, very small model. Then we used Rhino to create a 3D model. And in the 3D model, we created a structure for the primary structure was needed, which you see here. This is then the inner skin, and the outer skin is again acrylic double curved. So this was very, nobody knew at that time how to build it. And Peter asked me, would you be part of the team? And I said, of course, and said, if you come to London, which was Monday, and then said, you can, Wednesday we have a meeting with the client. It would be good to, if you see the client. It was not just a meeting, it was the first public presentation of this very special competition result. And then Peter was asked, yeah, you promised a lot in the competition this description, how will you build it? Peter said, okay, I have my engineer here. I told them I do not know how we do it, but we have a strategy always how to solve the problems, and then it was okay. So, and then we had some projects with Coop Himmelblau, some further projects, and we had a large project in Mexico and Guadalajara together, so we had an office there, and our people also, we were also there in this office with several people. And there we created the clouds. First we had, this is the project, a cultural center with theaters, cinemas, and an overall roof. We started with this kind of roof, but was said, this is not that what I would, what I had in my mind, so we should. And then we had a meeting there, a very funny meeting, and I asked him, what do we want to have? And he said, what about clouds? And then I said, okay, let's create a cloud. And we took our tools, our we used as engineers, and created a grid, an upper grid and lower grid, and deformed this grid by loads which had to do, not real loads, but loads which had to do with the meaning of the buildings underneath. And so we got the structure, which is a very efficient structure for, as engineers, as an engineer, I told the loads where they should deform the structure in which way, so that where we needed a higher structure by, for the higher bending moments and the large cantileverings, we made it thicker there. But we had at once a 3D model. So the client stopped the project then, but the idea still was there, and we did it once again in the BMW world in Munich. We did it the same way. We took an upper crit and a lower crit, deformed. The upper crit was deformed by gravity, negative gravity, to create a pillow-like structure. And the lower crit again was deformed by forces coming from the meaning of the space underneath. And then we connected these both layers by diagonals and got the created by this a very stiff structure. Maybe you know that building. And this kind of diagram shows what the goal really is. The goal is to deny gravity. Yeah, the floating structure. In the end, of course, there are very few columns underneath it, but however, it still looks rather floating. So another issue always is not to to see a building as an integrated structure. Yeah, you have the architecture, you have your design, you have the structure, you have the MEP stuff. And the goal is to bring all together in an optimized way. And in this building I want to show you, which I want to show you now, we did it somehow this way. It's a design school in Germany, in Essen, with Sana, just a cubicle box. I think I do it this way. So, and Sana, coming from Japan, wanted to do a very thin wall, if possible without insulation, which is normally not possible. You have to have a load-bearing shell, you have to have the insulation, you have to have ventilation, and you need an outer skin. And if it should look from inside as from outside like solid concrete, it's very difficult to realize. So then came up the idea Matthias Schuler, Transolar, which is known here as well, I guess. He's was involved in this project, and then came up sometimes had the idea there is a mine underneath, and they pump warm water, 28 degrees Celsius warm water, directly into the river nearby. And this water can heat the building, and that's what we then did. Yeah, we had these tubes inside a concrete structure to heat up the outer walls, and also to heat the slabs, so that we got a very thin outer wall. And we had also these tubes in the slabs, as you see here. And to make the slab lighter, we wanted to reduce the columns. There are only two columns in the building. That's why the slab has a certain thickness. And to make it to save weight, we introduced these bubbles. So, and as you see here, everything is integrated in the walls, even the drainage of the, I forgot the word. Silt, the silt, yes, thank you. So, you don't see any MEP stuff. This is the smoke exhausting thing. I asked these guys, normally you have always these, where do you have it here, yeah? Huge openings. How can you manage to have only this thing there? Yeah, we did. This is the office space.
Does it stay warm?
Pardon?
Does it stay warm?
Yes. I have to say yes, for there are, yes, some people say it doesn't work, so we ask the people there and they say it's cold and it's warm in summer and cold in winter, but I was there and I had the feeling it's warm in winter and cool in summer. So, and then came up the idea to handle this complicated geometrical stuff by building up parametric scripts. And we started with that when we worked together with Dominique Perrault on the Mariinsky Theater in St. Petersburg. Yeah, it's a theater inside and a golden skin wrapped around. So, and that's how we wanted to build this skin. You see, it's a triangle structure. That means each triangle is similar, but not the same. So, and to make the work easier, to handle this, so we scripted in Visual Basic that time. And it made really the work much more easier. I show you this for you. It's a kind of Stone Age, what I show you now, but it's not long ago. But it shows a kind of the last 10 years' developments. Yeah, quite different thing. I also like small projects very much. So we did this when we worked on the Mariinsky. Dominique was asked to build a cafe on the city hall. He built a city hall in Innsbruck. And they asked me, do we have an idea? And then we came up the idea with this glass pavilion, it should be curved, and then I said, okay, if it's curved, if the glass is curved, we do not need any additional steel structure. It could be the structure itself if it's fixed at the bottom. And that's the whole structure, very reduced, simplified. And the roof is a steel ring, which is not load-bearing for this glass structure, which is just there to support the membrane, which is stretched between this ring. Yeah, and you see the nozzle for the drainage. Every second pane is load-bearing, and every second is to open. And in the end, they pulled down this nozzle and to stretch or give the membrane the curvature, and that's it. And that time, we also started to let a computer generate structures. Yeah, what now, Clemens, yeah, is all included in Caramba. No, all these steps are necessary to lead to a tool like Caramba.
But we have Caramba, we don't need you anymore.
Maybe. This was my goal, yeah, to step back and let the Caramba do it. So we did this project in Naples with Dominique Perrault. It's a metro station, and the roof above this metro station combined with a mall, which is cut inside the plaza. It's cut in the plaza. And the roof should connect this mall to the Garibaldi Plaza place. So, and there we looked for a folded structure. There are lots of folded structure. I'm sure you all know this book, Engel, or not, maybe not. So you can look for suitable structures and take one. But we wanted to try to let a computer do it, and better than you can do it by hand, and efficient, more efficient. And the idea was to have this triangle grid and let the computer vary the or pick up or pull down the joints like that to get a stiff structure. So this flat structure was the first step, and then we created this design, this tree like things. So, and how does the computer do this? It's a generic algorithm. I guess you know the principles of it now. You start with a random generation. Yeah, it's somehow folded, and the computer does it by accident. And the computer evaluates these generations, for example, taking the deflection. And then the computer takes the individual with the best or the lowest deflection and combines it with the next best ones. So then there is a generation which has a better behavior than the first generation. And you also can introduce mutation. So, and so on. And here is an example. It's not so, you don't get it so quickly, but it shows the deflections over the generations. These are the generations here. Yeah, this is the first generation with these high deflections, and the next generations always have lower deflections, and so on. And then you can stop and say, and look at the individuals and choose one. And what I find very interesting, it's like in nature, all are good, nobody is the best. There is no optimum. There is not one which is extraordinary good. We are all like that in an acceptable range. So at this kind of generic creating of structures we used several times, for example, by designing this bridge at the airport in Frankfurt. Yeah, the diagonals are seemingly randomly, but as you have seen here, it's always controlled by the computer so that in the end you get an optimized result. This was the where the elements we used. We used these U-shaped brackets, not only the diagonals. We used these U-shaped brackets. We tried several things, and but with these brackets we got a certain disordered order or order in the disorder. And that's what I always say, which is important. It should not be only chaotic. There should be be able to feel a certain order behind it. But it's a long way in the future to tell, that's what we are discussing now, should we give the computer also aesthetic rules or not? It's very interesting. Pardon? Not really in that way that we tell him what aesthetics is, but we can, the input can be that way that we, as we did here, exclude total chaotic solutions. And this is my favorite bridge. It's it's 1750s, Canaletto in England. And what you see here is this bridge was done by craftsmen, not engineers. What engineers introduced later at about 1850 is you have to design it in triangles and you have to design it regular. The reason was that it could be easier calculated. Yeah, things like that are impossible since 150 years. And now, with means of the computer, we can go back to structures like that. Another example where we use this generic way of creating structures is this arena with Korb-Himmelblau. Yeah, it's this twisted structure. And also the roof structure is, it's a double layer roof structure, it's a truss. It's also twisted. That means the upper grid and the lower grid are twisted and you have to create by hand as an engineer the diagonals in between or the structure in between. And one possibility are things like that. But we thought this couldn't be the final result, and we let the computer do it. Yeah, we gave the computer the upper grid and the lower grid, and let the computer create the diagonals. And that's the outcome. It's again, order in disorder, disorder in order. And we even used it by designing the bracing elements in the project for the European Central Bank in Frankfurt with Korb-Himmelblau. Yeah, it's a double tower. You can consider it as two towers, but you also can consider it as one. One building for the two towers are connected by these diagonals, but we did not want, Korb-Himmelblau and we did not want to have a regular engineer-like structure, or the engineer-driven structure. So we again let the computer create these diagonals and optimize them, and this is, in the end, the outcome we had. So these are the struts connecting the both towers, 1 meter to 1 meter. The plates are 10 centimeters thick. This is the embedded part, in the concrete embedded part, to transfer the forces from the steel strut to the concrete structure. So, and one big challenge was the project we did with Sana in Lausanne in Switzerland for the ETH, also the technical university there. This was the project in the competition. It was a big competition. There were many people, Saha, Peter Eisenman, and Rem Koolhaas, and many. So, and this, pardon? And Saha won it with this one-story building. All the other designs were multi-story buildings. And it's just a flat pavilion, but folded up a little bit. It's like a mixture between, or taking a Mies building, one-story Mies building, and making Brasilia. Bitte? Making, thank you. I'm getting old, sorry. And making Niemeyer out of it. So, but the challenge for us was how to do this structure when the foundation, kind of foundation slab, suddenly folds up and spans 80 meters long instead of sitting on the ground. So, that's the problem. Yeah? The buckling of this shell-like thing. And we did lots of research work and solved it then by taking the, by looking where are the following the forces and reinforcing the shell along the forces in a normal range. The area the shell is 60 centimeters thick, and here it is 80 centimeters. So that means we created kind of arches here, and these arches are tied together by post tension cables in the slab underneath, which is the slab over the garage there. There's a one-story garage underneath. Yeah, the next challenge was how to handle this geometry in the shop drawings. So we did not conventional shop drawings. We created 3D files, which then they used to CNC cut these formwork elements. It's a very smooth surface in the end. The reinforcement of the shell was a very interesting sight there. And that's the shell with the, so the reinforced rib-like elements there. Yeah, it looks very light. If you see it in reality, it really looks floating. And you wonder, how does this work? And then the one-story pavilion was constructed very simply. The roof followed exactly the shape of the shell underneath. That's why we used wooden elements, which could be cheaper milled at the surface. And that's the result. The inside. It's a learning center. Yeah, it's open for all students and public as well, as a library and so on. So, next challenge, large cantilever, not only large, the largest cantilever in the world. It's the Busa Cinema Center with Coop Himmelblau. It's a cinema center with a cinema block, which is cannot exactly be seen here. It's a cinema block with several cinemas, with a theater and an open air area here. And this large roof here, which is a roof over a semi-public or public space. Yeah, for Coop Himmelblau, it is always important not only to create private space, but to create also public space in the projects. So, and the roof is supported by this cone-like element and is cantilevering over 85 meters here. And the story is we had this structure, this cantilevering structure in the competition, and but I had in my mind nobody, the client will not pay for it. So in the first presentation, we showed the project with some tilted columns here, which also looked nice, but it's not a cantilevering structure. But I thought before the client says go home and come back with columns, we said we show the columns for Korea, as Seoul is far, Busan is far away, and we would not like to travel that much back and forth. But then the client said, the mayor said, you promised me a structure without columns, please do it. And then we did it, and it was okay for the client. And they, for them it was very important to be represented in the Guinness Book of Records with the largest cantilevering roof. Yeah, you know, it's again this cloud-like structure as we did in a BMW world with a lower grid and upper grid. That's not quite new. New is as you see here, upper grid, lower grid, diagonals in between. New is this challenge with this very wide, very large cantilever, so we had to consider the deflection very well. We had to consider the typhoon there. We did wind tunnel tests, a lot of wind tunnel tests, and everything was proved, and it works. That's how they built it. Yeah, the long cantilever was built up on the ground and then lifted up. That's the double cone, the support structure. And that's the roof before the surface was cladded. And what you see here, these holes, that's what we talked about. The client said, okay, you designed it for typhoons worth 280 kilometers, but what happens if in 50 years the typhoons have whatever as speed? Nobody knows. So, and the client, without asking us, he said, or he said, we want to be safe. And what they did then is they have columns, hydraulic columns, in underneath the plaza, and if the and they can be was ausgefahren, not to support the roof, but to avoid the twist of the roof. But we said it's safe as we designed it. So if you pay for it, if he pays for it, yeah. Here you see these little openings. It's not only the cantilevering, which brings load, that there are additional bridges underneath. Yeah, and this is the so-called small roof above the open air space. Yes, some pictures which show the, it's a screen as well, which so, and we are in Ohio here, and this was some time earlier, the Akron Museum was cantilevering a roof as well. But it's not cantilevering that much as it should. You see this column here. What we designed was not a column. Also, we did the design in Austria, Germany, and we had a partner here who did the shop drawings. And when I came to Akron and asked him, "What are you doing here?" It's not a rope; it's a strut. The rope should avoid the twisting of the roof. And he then took it as a support for it makes the roof cheaper, but it's. As you all know, perhaps now we can, using Rhino on the and whatever, we can design every surface, every curvature, but if it in the end, if it should be built, how can it be done? And that's where we all have to work on now and in future. And what we tried here is, you saw these bubbles, Kunsthaus and so on, there we did it with acrylic. And here when we did this project with Sahatit, we wanted to try it together with the contractor with glass. Yeah, acrylic has certain disadvantages. Glass is living longer, and the thermal expansion is lower than if you have it with acrylic. Acrylic always has the problem then in terms of the thermal expansions in the joint, in the joints to keep them waterproof. So we wanted to do it in glass. But first we had to create an inner structure which is load-bearing, and this bearing the glass skin. And then we had, in this case we made it easy for the contractor, and easy always means to have vertical cuts to create shapes which easily can be CNC cut. Then we had to do the paneling. No. And then the problem was who produces this glass. So there was a contractor for the glass in Austria, but then he said, no, I can't do it in the end for for the owner of this company changed, and they said, no, we don't do it. So the next possibility was there was no one else who could do it in Europe, who would do it in Europe. So, but the Chinese companies are very open for things like that. And so it was done in China. The German, the Austrian version would have been to mill elements, foam concrete elements, and use that as a mold. And but in China they have cheap people, but not the machines, so they did it by hand. And the result was not that good, of course, not so exact. Then it would be by doing it with milled molds. For if you have in this workflow, in the digital workflow, if you have some handcraft in between, you lose the exactness in the end. So, but however, they were forced, the Chinese people were forced to control the tolerances and not to ship it if they are beyond 5 millimeters. But in some cases they did it however. So the joints sometimes were 2 centimeters wide. Yeah, the next issue to solve was how to fix the glass on this different, with a different declination to the steel structure, and we did lots of research, and in the end we came up with this version, which is a low-tech, high-tech version, yeah, no mechanical elements, just we have just these plastic elements which are milled according to the surface. And there the glass elements could easily be screwed directly to this into the structure. So, and then came up Grasshopper, which made the things much more easier in terms of parametric design. Yeah, it was not any longer necessary to script all special, to do special scripts for special tasks. So with Grasshopper, as you now see, you can solve the most problems. So we had, we worked on this stadium together with German architects, RKW. And here we had, we had many similar elements, but not identical elements again. This should be a film, but it does not work. But you know how the grasshopper surface looks. So by we gave in one truss, and by changing the parameters of this one truss, we could create all the others at once. And this helped us a lot. So we could do it very quickly. And that's the outcome. This was the first time that we used Grasshopper, or it was again the better version of Grasshopper we used. Yeah, quite different challenge is not to show structure. Reduce structure, reduce everything. Genesana project, Louvre Dépendance in northern France. The opening was 1 month ago. Yeah, there are several pavilion-like museum buildings, some in glass, some opaque, and that's the result. So our goal was to show as less structure as possible. And the goal of SANA was to show as less building as possible. For example, they curved these walls so that the reflections are not are different than if it would be straight. And the surface of the walls of the opaque buildings is brushed aluminium, but in a special way brushed so that the reflection is that way, that it looks like clouds, heaven. And you see it here. I was there on site before the opening, and you see the one element where they tested it, that it looks like sky. And that's the building now. So. And that's just what they promised in the competition. They did drawings where you didn't see anything, or nearly nothing. Yeah, the columns as thin as possible. It looks quite easy, but it's not for engineers that easy to, yeah, you have to, what about the bracing of the building and so on, and the bending moments in the columns, so there's all to be solved, with the goal to make everything as thin as possible. And that's the inside of the opaque museum rooms, with the paintings in the end. Yeah, you do not so really know where you are there. So, and that's the roof structure, which should not look like structure. But of course it is structure. It's just two plates welded together. So another real challenge with Dominic Perrault was to do his high rise in Vienna. Yeah, there are two high rises face to face with one undulated facade, and the other facades are straight. And Dominic wanted to have it as slim as possible. And the slenderness here is less than 1 to 10, and 1 to 10 is a kind of border you should not go through. And here we have less than 1 to 10, and we found one building in New York which has a similar slenderness, but in New York there do not exist these strong rules about accelerations we have in Europe. So in the end here again you see the slenderness. We did it by connecting the cores to the outer columns, yeah, to let the building as far as possible, as wide as possible to support the building with a wide span. And that's how we connected it to the foundation slab. The foundation slab. And it would, the building is safe as it is here, but the problem is if there is, if it's very windy, stormy, you have, you can feel the acceleration. You can feel that it swings. And there are very, they want to rent it for a high price, and so they fear that people don't accept this. That's why we proposed a damper. Yeah, the damper is a huge mass of 300 tons. And swings with the in a different direction than the building is swinging, and so it damps the whole the accelerations of the building. Yeah, and here they built up the bottom plates of this damper. As you see, it's a huge mess. It's easier to fill it in afterwards. Water does the same than steel, but it's more volume.
Why not all water?
Pardon?
Why not a lot more water?
Then it would be too high. Yeah, it's a compromise between volume and weight. No, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, this are the slabs following this undulated facade. So we went on in this parametric design by used it by designing museums building in Frankfurt. There is an existing art museum in Frankfurt, which is this, and they wanted to add an additional space, which is this, and there is a this was a former garden, and it's still and it again is a garden on the roof. So, and this is a shell like structure with a relatively long span here, and there are different openings. The openings are all different but similar. So, and here we created the geometry together with the architects with our parametric tools. Yeah, this was the competition entry. So first we created the shape by using ANSYS, which is a technical tool where we created the optimized space by deforming it in the computer, and then we used Grasshopper to create all these openings with their very difficult geometry, as you see here. The formwork was done by milling foam. And then we had to design the reinforcement. We even did the reinforcement planning by using Grasshopper. And we even did the post-tensioning, the design of the post-tensioning cables by using Grasshopper. Yeah, here you see the whole stuff is inside this slab. There is nothing underneath the slab. All the technical elements. it's painted white, and so it looks like a very lightweight. It doesn't look like concrete. Yeah, people, many people said, why don't you show this concrete? The architect said, it's not a material, it's the, we want the lightness. And it really looks very light. And there is again the garden on top of it. So the next step was to introduce building information modeling. We did it first time when we worked on this project with Corp Himmelblau in Shenzhen. It's the museum in the center of the city. It's a double museum, art and urban planning. This is art, thousands of square meter, and urban planning, thousands of square meter. The structure is, does not have any columns, only the cores. And the floors are double floors, which cantilever. So, and then, and there is a skin above all this, around all this. And then we used first time digital project together with Corp Himmelblau. We all sat together in one room and together designed, did this drawings. Maybe you know how this looks. It was a great experience, and this is, of course, what we have to do now, and in the future you all have to use it. So, and we went on using the computer, not in terms what Karamba does, but I have the feeling that we can, the computer can create structure and optimize structures. But can the computer also, the question is, can the computer also create space? And that's what we tried in this competition together with German-Australian architects, LABA. This was the outcome. And the way how we created is, we gave, first we gave the computer a tool set of these elements, and then we gave the computer rules we said where the areas with a higher or lower density should be. We said where the voids should be and where openings big openings to outside should be. So, and we did it the same method again with the generic script. Yeah, the first generation is random. The first generation is evaluated by first how is the load bearing. Or how is the load bearing behavior, and are these other rules, the spatial rules, fulfilled? And then come the next generation, and it really worked. Yeah, and there is a whole generation of lots of individuals of which come out, and you can choose one. And for example, we chose that. Of course, we did not win this competition, but it's I plan to go on this way and do some research work. Yeah, that can, I think there will happen something in this direction in the future. And then we had the great solution. We had Karamba, thanks to Clemens. And just to show one example, where, or two examples where we used it, and then I come to the end. We had first, Clemens could explain it much more better than I can explain it, but the essential thing in Caramba is in, or I said, what we did before is we created a geometric model and then gave the data to a structural model, and this forth and back, and this took time. And Caramba now is a totally integrated program. And based on Grasshopper and so on, also easy to use. At first, Caramba can is the program we always waited for you get, you can create a geometry and get the results in real time. You can change the geometry very, very easily and look on the other screen and see the behavior. So you can directly prove your design. Or what Caramba also can do now in combination now with Grasshopper, it's done by Galapagos, create structure in this generic way. And that's what we did here in this project, creating the structure. It's a energy producing building. But we started first in a meeting to talking about the structure and the situation of the columns, and we saw it's very difficult to get a column straight through it. So then we said, why not using V-shaped and A-shaped elements? But if then you place them by hand, it's again difficult. Why not let Caramba do it? Yeah, these are these V-shaped and A-shaped columns. That's now the part of how it's worked out now. And we gave the computer areas where the columns could be and areas where no columns should be. So, and that's what the computer in the end did. What we evaluated is the structural behavior. So in the end, we get an optimized structure. What you see is that here the deflection gets lower and lower. And in the end, we used again building information modeling to do the final, not only the final drawings, all drawings, but also the final drawings. So the last example for last project and last example for Caramba is this pavilion designed by Summa. Once I got a telephone call, oh, we have an idea and have an idea for a pavilion, but we only want to have sticks like that sticking out. Could this be a structure? As an engineer, it's difficult to create a structure out of it, but for Caramba, it's quite easy. So that's again the way how Caramba does it. Caramba is considering the deflections, and in the end, there is a structure with very low deflection, and this works. And that's how it was built then in the end. Just sticks with very few connections in between. And there is, in the end, there is a membrane inside. So that's it. Thank you. maybe it's not so bad to step back. But not to be serious, I do not think that a computer can replace architects or engineers so easily. Yeah, it's even if we let a computer create structures or even space in maybe in some years, I'm sure this will come. But still, we have the architects and the engineers have to get the input and then decide what to take.
An architect can look at beauty for 10 years and say, you know what, I'm tired of that, I want ugly. And you know, that actually happens a lot. You know, where what was an important value of judgment or aesthetics, there became an anti-aesthetic. You know, I want the rustication or ugly surfaces or brutalism. So it's harder in engineering to imagine that you would want inefficient structures or clumsy structures. There does seem to be an ethos of optimization in engineering that is not true in architecture. So it's virtually impossible for me to imagine computerized architectural design. I don't believe it's possible to think about computerized engineering design. But I guess what I'm asking you is there such a thing as aesthetic tendencies?
There is no general tendency, but I have my personal. I really want to go back to these wonderful structures, as I showed you. Yeah, these craftsmen-like made structures, and the structures got very poor when they started to calculate it. Yeah, the means of calculation, design.
So when those guys built that bridge, they didn't calculate.
No.
So
750. 50.
Yeah, they put like they put 10 sticks up. Somebody crossed it, it broke. And they said, "Oh, we need 10 more sticks." And then how did they know? Like, if you don't make some kind of, did it all model things?
They had a feeling.
Had a feeling.
They had a feeling. But you know, the Gothic churches often broke down.
But
some survived.